What happened in October 312 in Rome? That's a very interesting question. 2 years ago, I was asked by a group of Christian businessmen in a city in southern Germany whether I could give a lecture, for they had in that city, not the Christian group, but the city had an exhibition with the subject Rome 312. And it was an exhibition for 9 or more months. It was in a gasometer. I don't know whether you know what that is. It's a is that an English word? Gasometer is very what? Gasometer. Ah, yeah. And it was a in this was a 40-meter panorama picture from the and it showed the morning 29th of October 312 when Constantine went into advanced in Rome after he has won the battle against Maxentius. And though this Christian group asked me why I could give whether I could give a historic evangelistic lecture on that. And so I said, okay, I can give a lecture about Dan Brown, the Da Vinci Code, and Caesar Constantine, what did really happen on October 312 in Rome. More than 100 people came, and this Christian group works with this attitude to invite the people who are non-Christians to come a few weeks later on a Saturday to learn what it means to become a Christian, to live as a Christian, and so on. And they wrote me after this lecture, they had never so many people arriving to these things, 25 non-Christians showed up. That was very much for them. So. And I started my lecture with the words that I think that what you know about the Caesar Constantine you have learned out of the book from Dan Brown. For in this book, The Da Vinci Code, there Dan Brown is one of the bad guys in that book. So it's not only a fiction with bad and good guys, but only with bad and good guys in history. And Constantine is a bad guy in history. And Dan Brown is saying two things about Constantine. First, he says, he, at the Council of Nicaea, he has put up the New Testament as we have it now. He put in the Gospels as we have it now. And second, he was not a Christian. His conversion was a fake. He was not a Christian. He was only interested in power politics. And then I told the people that the first point of Dan Brown is totally wrong. At the Council of Nicaea, there was not debated about the right Gospels, but on the basis of the right Gospels, they had to make a decision at the Council of Nicaea. But the second question is a question with which the historians deal till today. The question, was the conversion of Caesar Constantine a real conversion, or was it just power politics? And I can tell you what is latest news of the historians about these subjects. First, I have to tell you, historians are looking for evidence, and evidence must always be evaluated, and the evaluation of evidence is different. People differ in evaluation. That is one is a question of experience, life experience, job experience. Sometimes it's a question of worldview. If you have different worldviews, then sometimes you come to different conclusions. And even in the question of Caesar Constantine, I once read in one of the books that how people evaluate Constantine has something to do how they evaluate Christianity. So even history is not so easy, it is only objective truth. So you have evaluation and you have worldviews. And so what I'm tell you is what I think, or what is there the majority now thinks about the conversion of Caesar Constantine. But you must be aware that there are professors of ancient history who have another opinion. And I will tell you what are the debates. What are the hints for people to think that the conversion was right or was not right? The debate started in the middle of the 19th century by Jakob Burckhardt. He was a very famous historian, and he was the first, after Voltaire was of the same opinion, that Constantine was not a religion man, he has no interest in Christianity, no conversion, he was only power politics. And this statement of Jacob Burckhardt, without any evidence, but it was his conviction, this lasted for nearly 80 years. In the year 1930, around the year 1930, a British historian, he has another thesis, and more and more this other thesis, that the conversion of Constantine was a real conversion, and he was a real Christian from the beginning when he started in Rome. This is now more or less the major opinion of historians in Germany and other parts of Europe, and I think in the United States as well. Before we come to the life of Constantine, I give only an impression. What is the debate? What are the evidence? And what is the evidence? And what is the discussion? First, I can tell you that in the Orthodox Church, Constantine is a saint. And the day of celebration of Constantine as saint is the 21st of May. So we are right in time today. Please, please, Stacey, please be seated. First, to come in this century with Constantine. Constantine was born, some historians say, in the year 272. Other historians say in the year 285. So we have really difference. It's a longer difference than about the birth of Jesus, by the way. Nobody knows. So 272, 2085. This is when Constantine was born. His father was one of the Caesars in that time, in the year 305 and 306. In that time, at the beginning of the 4th century, the Roman Empire had four different Caesars. They had divided the Roman Empire in West and East, and both parts, West and East, had two different emperors. Caesars. One was a leading one and the other was next time leading, but not now. And his father was the leading person in the West, in the north of the West. So that means France, Germany, Spain. And there was another Caesar who was leading in the south, that means Italy, including Rome. And then you have other Caesars at the east. In 306, his father died. And Constantine was elected by the soldiers, by the army, to become his successor. That was not the idea. The idea was that he had another successor, but the military said, no, we want Constantine. And so Constantine, from the year 306, was the new Caesar in the northern part of the West Roman Empire. In the southern part, there was a man called Maxentius. It is very difficult to explain all these things, so I will not do that, for we have only one question, the conversion of Constantine, not the other things. But to show you the background, 306, both started, Maxentius in the southwest, Constantine in the northwest. And in 312, Constantine started at the end of 311, he went from Trier, Germany, where he lived, to Rome. And then he had this battle before Rome against Maxentius. Maxentius died, and in 306, Constantine was emperor, was Caesar of the west part of the Roman Empire. And in 324, he defeated the man who was the emperor on the east side. And so, from 324, he was the only Roman Caesar, till his death in 337. Another thing what is important, from 333 to 311, we have the strongest persecution of Christians during the whole years of the Roman Empire. You have this long distance. In the year 30, Christ was crucified and then resurrected, and till 311, Christianity was not a permitted religion in the Roman Empire. And in 303 to 311, they had the strongest persecution of Christianity. But in some parts of the Roman Empire, in the western part, in the northwestern part, with his father and with Constantine, they did not really do this persecution. It was more in the east. So that is another factor in that time. And then maybe you have heard that in school, in the night before the battle against Maxentius, Constantine had a dream. And Jesus came in his dream and said, in this sign you will win. And so in the next day he changed all the signs, and all the people, all the soldiers had the Christian sign. Christian signs, that means the two letters of the starting words of Christ, she and ro, the Christian, the Greek letters she and ro, the first two letters of Christ, were on their shields, and then they went into that battle and won this battle. But historians think that is not totally true, this story. In earlier time, many historians thought that is totally wrong, but we have two traditions about the situation before this battle. One is from Lactantius. He was a famous Christian apologist. He was professor of rhetoric, and he was on the court of Diocletian till 303. In 303, Diocletian in the east, in Nicomedia, started the persecution of the Christians, and a short time earlier, Lactantius left his court. And Lactantius wrote about this battle from Constantine against Maxentius, and he has this this story that in the night before, Constantine had this dream. Then we have another tradition, Eusebius. He has written two books, one about church history and one about Constantine. And he met Constantine latest in 325 and had many conversations with him. And he quoted in his second book on Constantine that Constantine had told him that before he started against Maxentius, he had a vision on a day about the Christian, about Christ and the Christian God. And in this sign of the Christian God, he then started his battle against Maxentius. So we have two different things. And now the historian thinks that these things cannot be combined. They must be departed. And now we come to a third dream of the vision of Constantine in the year 310 in South France. It is reported that Constantine had a vision on a day, and others saw the same, and he thought it was in the near of a temple of Apollo. He saw that this was a vision and a sign from Apollo to him, or from Sol Invictus, the unbeatable sun that was a sign for him and his career. But now the historians have the following conclusion. This, what he saw in this night, in this day on 310, was not a sign of Apollo, but he saw, as people call it, a so-called halo. I don't know whether you know that. That is, there are clouds and there is the sun, and then you can see a sign in the sun. And what you can see in the sun with this special halo, maybe you can find it in Wikipedia, I don't know, is a cross in that. And that was what Constantine had seen. And then afterwards, maybe in the same year afterwards, people told him that is not the sign of Apollo or Sol Invictus, that is the sign of the Christian God, the cross. And then in 310 or in 311, Constantine decided, why, nobody knows, but he decided to start his battle against Maxentius under this sign. And he put this sign, and the sign is always this she and ro, the first two Greek letters of Christos, of Christ, she and ro. He put this sign on his helmet, and he put this sign on the on a flag for his soldiers. There you see the sign of the she and the ro, the Christ thing. And then he started at the end of 311 to Rome, arrived there at October 312, and then that can be, most historians think that might be the true, in 312, before this battle, even the soldiers on their shields, they get the sign, she and ro. That was a sign. And then they won this battle. Maxentius, or later Licinius, were more or less earlier pagan Caesars, or were enemies of the Christians. And Constantine really started his battle against Maxentius with a sign, and against Licinius, and all his battles after this battle, till the end of his life, all his battle with his she and Ro on the flag, she and Ro on his helmet, she and Ro, maybe not in for all soldiers, but for the soldiers who were nearest to him. That is what the historians believe. So that is the first, the visions. This is not the vision only in the night before, but is a vision which started 310, Apollo Sol Invictus, and was interpreted that is not Sol Invictus, but that is Jesus Christ. And then he started with a Christian god from 311. So he became a Christian, as we can say that, in 310 or 311, and he started under the sign of, as he understood, the Christian Shi and Ro in 311, his career. So that is the first point. The second point, what happened on the 29th of October 312? There was one fascinating event. When, after the battle, he came into Rome, he, for the first time ever, a Roman Caesar, did not go to the Jupiter temple and had no sacrifices to the god Jupiter. And that was very, it was a big surprise for the people then. He went with his horses to the temple, but then he went left. And he never in his life ever entered a temple of Jupiter after this day. And that is very surprising, for all Caesars went into the temple of Jupiter, for the temple Jupiter is the highest god, and all what you have, you own him, and you have to be thankful for him. But he never, ever in his life, went into a Jupiter temple. In the 1st of January 313, there was a celebration for him, and it was a new celebration, and all Caesars, if they start with such a celebration, they had to go into the Jupiter temple. He did not. In 314, there was a big event in Rome. All 110 years, they had a very big event of celebration, and the Caesar had to go in the Jupiter temple. Constantine did not. And in 315, 25, and 35, when he celebrated his reign, he never, ever went into that temple. And that needs an explanation. One historian has the following explanation. Constantine had a very near relationship to Lactans. As I told you, Lactans, a Christian philosopher. When Lactans was at the court of Diocletian, Constantine lived for 1-2 years in that court, and so they knew each other. And then Lactans in 303 left this court, and later, people are not sure, historians, when later, that can be 310, maybe a few years earlier, or a few years later than 310, Constantine invited Lactans to come to him to Trier, where he lived, and to educate his eldest son, Crispus. So that is, I think that is a little commitment, or more than a little commitment, and it shows that Constantine trusted Lactans, and so it might be very clear that they had some conversations. And some historians think that Lactans has written a book about what it means to be a Christian. And he says there are many steps to become a Christian and to be a Christian. The first step is, if you are a Christian, it is not allowed to sacrifice any other god. So some people think that when Constantine went into Rome on that morning, on the 29th of October, he remembered what Lactans has told him, and he never, ever went into the temple of Jupiter. In that time, there were so-called panegyrica, people who give positive speeches about Caesar. And in 313, we have this speech, Panegyrica said about, when Constantine was there, he said about Constantine, it was very surprising that you did not go into the temple, but very quick left to another place in Rome. So this was an event which the people in that time really made think, and that event needs an explanation. So we have this temple going of Constantine, or better say, not temple going of Constantine. What needs an explanation? The next point, in the same year, 312, the letters of Constantine. We have 38 letters of Constantine which deal with religious questions. And we have speeches of Constantine which deal with religious questions. And that's another point which brought more and more about the decades, the historians, to the conclusion that the conversion of Constantine was, out of his perspective, a real conversion and not power politics. Though let's have a short look at the letters. First, we have two letters to the consul of North Africa, living in Carthago. And it's in the one of the first days after 29th of October was the first letter. And Constantine wrote this man that the first thing what he had to do now is to give the Christians back their buildings or whatsoever they have, to bring them back. The persecution, as I said, were very strong between 303 and 311. The persecutions were in 311 were finished by Galerius. He was a successor of Diocletian, and he in 311 says, we will stop the these persecutions, and the reason was they are of no use, no success. We have no success with the persecutions. The Christian groups are getting stronger and stronger, and that is an argument which Constantine often in the years used, he says, is the strongness of the Christian God is shown that persecution have no result on him. And in 313, that is after his fight against Maxentius, then Constantine and Licinius, the king in the east, they decided together that from now on Christianity is a permitted religion. This was not till 311 a permitted religion, as a Jews a permitted religion. The Christians were not the first 300 years in the Roman Empire. And they said there will now be a permitted religion, and that means to give back their the books and to give back their houses. Persecution means to kill the leaders and to destroy the houses and destroy Bibles and such things. But that only some parts of the Roman Empire took place, mostly in the east, not in the west where Constantine was Caesar. And then he wrote this man in Carthago, though that's the first thing you have to do, give the Christians the buildings back. And in, I think, even in October, it's only 2 days of October, Constantine started with church building in Rome, and in the next years he built many churches in the Roman Empire. He financed them and he built them. That was for one reason to bring back this to the Christians, but it was more than this. Other Caesars did the same in former times, building temples. Constantine never built any temple in the Roman Empire, but always churches, only in the West, and after 324 in the East. Although we have two letters to this pagan governor of North Africa to say that is what we have to do. That's very important to build Christian houses and to give the Christians back what belongs to them. Though these are the first letters to a pagan governor. Second, we have many letters to bishops, starting in 313, and he called the bishops brothers and said, I'm one of you. And a very interesting point is that he always said, I'm a slave of Christ, so that is what he felt, what he should say to the bishops. And he is interested that there is a unity among the Christians and that he will fight for the unity among the Christians. And then we have other letters from him about Christianity. The most interesting letter is to the king of Persia, Shapur II. This is written in 324-325. He wrote this letter and said, congratulations to you, for as I have heard in Persia, there are Christians. The best what you can have, Christians. They are good for your country and helps them, protects them and all these things. They will pray for you and all these things, and they belong to the God who is emperor of, is a God of the whole world and such things. And historians who are not Christians, Ryan wrote that this is from Constantine. He wrote this letter to win Shapur for the Christian belief. So that's a very interesting letter to the king of Persia to advertise that he is a Christian, and that is very congratulate that you have Christians in your country. That really will help you in ruling this country. So you have these were a few examples of the letters we have from Constantine, which deal directly with religious questions. Then the next point, so we have letter, the next point, coins. That's a very interesting thing for propaganda. And in the first coin where a Christian symbol is found is in 315, that is very near to 312. In 315 we have the first coins. There are people who think maybe they were from 330, but the majority thinks that it are coins from 350. And on that coin we found Constantine, and on his helmet he has his shield and robe. It is very interesting, from now on, if we find on the coins the Christian symbol, it is not outside of Constantine, it's always on Constantine, the Christian symbol. So on his helm, everywhere. It's not on the coin, it's always on Constantine, the Christian symbol. So from 350 you find this Christian symbol. But you find a symbol for Sol Invictus and other things. Why that? Some people think, though it shows he was not a real Christian, otherwise he would damage the other coins with Sol Invictus and such things. But when Constantine started as a Christian in 312, there were only a few Christians in the Roman Empire. It is only guessing, but most of the historians think that at that time, 312, we have 5 to 10% of the people in the Roman Empire were Christians, and most of them, nearly all of them, most of them in the East. That's another question about the debate about power politics. If Constantine wanted to show himself as a Christian out of power politics, then that would be of no use. Then if you want to have a power as a Roman Caesar, you need your support of the military, you need the support of the Senate, and you need the support of the administration. And in 312, you will find only a few Christians in the army, in the Senate, maybe no Christian in the Senate, and only a few Christians in the administration. And not in his part, the few we will find it in the East, if you will find it in the East. And the Christians were not well respected to that time. They were not a permitted religion. But people think that maybe 5 to 10%. People think that maybe 70 million inhabitants we have in the Roman Empire at that time, 5 to 10% would mean 3.5 to 7 million, but mostly in the East, in cities or in the country. Constantine was interested in power politics, but more than 90%, maybe more than 95% of the inhabitants of the Roman Empire were not Christians, or maybe against the Christians. And therefore maybe he had no problem to show himself as a Christian, but to leave the others. He was convinced that religion, decisions of religion can only be made by free will, free choice. So some historians say that Constantine must be seen as a tolerant man, and tolerance in the modern sense. He always wrote, you can only be a Christian by free will and free choice. And he did not fight against pagans, and he did not fight against the Jews. He had not a positive opinion about the pagans and the Jews, but he said, okay, it's their free will. He only fought against heretics, for he was for the unity of the Christian church. From that, it's very positive that we have a unity in our church. We're only a small group. When he started, it was a small group, 5 to 10%. And that's only in the East, where he has no contact in 312. That was only his part, was only the West. So, and the tolerance maybe is another debate he had with Lactance. Lactance has written that in religious questions, it is only possible to change the opinion by free will, not on another way. Many people think that Constantine was responsible for this strong, narrow connection between state and church. But that his idea was that at the end, all the Romans should become Christians. All the world should become Christian. And he saw himself as someone whom God had given the task to help that all the people in the Roman Empire and all the people worldwide should become Christians. But free will. That was very important. He had, in one book I read, Constantine had two enemies, the Enlightenment and the Pietistic movement. Both were against him, for they thought he is responsible for this state and religious thing. But he was against that. But he has opened the doors. He had not favorized Christians in higher positions. There are books about that he always favorized pagan people, but not the Christians. But in his time, more and more of the Christians, more and more people became Christians. That is true. But that is an interesting point, that he had to realize that more than 90%, maybe more than 95% in under the people where he, whom he ruled were non-Christians or were opposite to it. But he was a Christian. He showed it everywhere in his letters, and everywhere he was on the signs, always Christianity with a she and ro. The cross is the first time in the year, the first coin is in the year 333. You find the first time a cross on a coin. And a few years earlier, Constantine had forbidden that a man or that someone will be crucified in the Roman Empire. Crucifixion was common in Roman Empire, but Constantine said, no, we will not crucify any person now. And then after this, in 333, you find the first coin with a cross. Before 33, there was no cross on any coin or elsewhere. So that started in the 4th century, that the cross became a sign for Christianity. It's a sign earlier, and it is the first time that on the flag, on the Roman flag, there was this she and ro sign in public, what Constantine then created or had the idea and did it, or Christian priests told him that he should do that as a result of this halo, this sign in the clouds. From the year 310. So we have this, we have the letters, we have the buildings, we have the coins. Another question, often people think Constantine was not a Christian, Dan Brown said the same, for he was baptized at the end of his life, one day before he died. On the 21st of May he died in 77, and the next day, 22nd, he died. So baptism and then death. That is for many people a very strong argument to say he was not a Christian. Maybe, as Dan Brown wrote, he was baptized against his will. But that is not true. In this century, and in the 3rd century, there was a custom, but which might sound very unusual to us, that many people had been baptized at the end of their life. They wanted to be baptized at the end of their life. That has to do something with the question, if in baptism all your sins are washed away, and that is good, that it's near the end. It's the best to have that near the end. So that was the idea. And Constantine had another problem. He wanted to be baptized in the Jordan River, as Jesus was baptized. And then when he, in May 37, he became very ill, and his people told him, you will never go to the Jordan. Then he agreed, okay, then there can be the baptism. There are a few examples in the 3rd and 4th century that people became bishops, but they were not baptized. They had the baptism after becoming a bishop. That does not mean they were no Christians when they were elected bishops, but they had the same idea. To have the baptism very late. So this is not an argument that the baptism of Constantine was very late. That is not an argument. So this is a debate. These are the arguments why more and more of the historians think that the conversion was very real. There is a very famous French ancient historian. He is, as he writes, an atheist and Marxist, so he's not a Christian. He has a very, in his book, How Our World Became Christian, he wrote about the 4th century, and he has a very positive attitude to Christianity in his book. He shows why Christianity became so strong, and he's very positive to Caesar Constantine. I mentioned that for this Paul Wayne is, as he says, an atheist, and he says now nobody has any doubt that Constantine's conversion was he was 100% a Christian. But Wayne is wrong. In Germany, there are people who have doubt that they believe what Charcot Burckhardt had said is right. As I said at the beginning, that the Orthodox Church has Constantine as a saint and celebrate his being a saint. The Western Church has not Constantine as a saint. There is at least one dark capital in his life. In the year 326, he killed or was responsible for the death of his wife and the first son, Crispus. And there is very less what is in the documents. Most of the historians, not only Wayne, but most of the historians think that it has something to do with betrayal, Hochverrat, or is that a word, that he wants to become a Caesar, and so that Constantine killed these two people. And therefore the Western Church said, that is not good to become a saint. We don't know what is behind that. Paul Wayne has no problem with that. He says that was in the last centuries common, that people, if they even in the own family, if there were people who want to kill the Caesar, that they were killed. So he thinks that is that was the times, though that it was in that time. So this was what I wanted to say what is now the debate. For it's a debate. The debate is therefore important for all people know that it was very crucial that for the Christian faith, looking from the outside, without not looking to any God, to say this was the main and the most important thing in world history, that the Roman Emperor Constantine started as a Christian in a time where the Christians had only a few percent and were despised in their country. And he started as a Christian, and he was from his starting point in 312, he was 25 years Caesar. That a long time. And he opened the door that Roman Empire and that Europe and all these places, even that Christianity became a world religion. And so the historians, they think, without Constantine that the history of Christianity had taken another place.